I'm just wondering, what's the point? Would it make any difference at all if I never existed?
Does it get easier?
No.
There is no enemy greater than your own mind, but there is no ally greater than your own mind.
Statistics show the shockingly high incidence of male suicide.
We have some terribly sad news to report this morning. Anthony Bourdain has died.
That man with that job hung himself in a luxury suite in France.
This is really about life or death and sanity, and I believe it is, then do whatever the hell it takes.
In 2014, I attended a silent 10-day meditation retreat. And as challenging as the retreat was, I soon discovered after the retreat that maintaining a daily practice of meditation is significantly harder. And since 2014, I found myself in a cycle of resistance and persistence. I'll meditate for 2-3 weeks in a row, and then I just abandon my practice. And then something happens in life, disappointment, rejection, struggle, and I come back to my practice. And I'm consistent for 1, 2, 3 weeks, and then it stops. And this has just been ongoing for year after year. Until finally, this past summer, I decided that I was going to commit to a daily practice.
If my brain was like a friend, I would like be like, yeah, dude, we can't do this anymore. Like, you're just bumming me out, man. I mean, Jesus Christ, do you ever see the light? Yeah. The fuck, you know? I just became aware of it. And I'd be like, all right, well, there's that thought. Do you want to have that thought or you want to go to the gym?
So what inspired me to commit? Well, if I'm going to be honest, at 27, I found myself becoming more and more apathetic towards life. At 27, I felt like I was already over life. And if I'm already over life at 27, what kind of attitude towards life will I have at 50? And will I even make it to 50? And when I thought about it, it kind of scared me. Because I feel like I'm too young to be this cynical and this pessimistic about life. And it wasn't too long ago when life was a gift. When I was a child, life felt like a gift. And now that I'm an adult, it was feeling like a burden. And for me, I wanted to understand how much of my own suffering is self-inflicted. Of course, there are external causes of suffering, and I don't want to diminish societal causes of suffering, but personally, I know that a lot of my suffering was self-inflicted and self-perpetuated. And for me, meditation was a chance and an opportunity to learn how to be here.
The world is like a ride at an amusement park, and when you choose to go on it, you think it's real, because that's how powerful our minds are. And the ride goes up and down and round. It has thrills and chills, and it's very brightly colored, and it's very loud. And it's fun for a while. Some people have been on the ride for a long time, and they begin to question, is this real or is this just a ride?
When I was thinking about who I wanted to interview for this video, I had a few names in mind. At the top of that list was a professor by the name of John Vervaeke. I came across John Vervaeke and his work last winter when I discovered the Awakening from the Meaning Crisis series on YouTube. I was on Twitter one day, and I saw a link that Jordan Peterson had shared. And it was linking to a lecture series conducted by one of his colleagues by the name of John Vervaeke. And I thought, okay, let me check out this link. I'm going through a meaning crisis. Maybe it's a coincidence, but let me see what this lecture series is all about. And I watched the first episode, and it was about an hour in length. And I knew that this was something special.
Or are you trying to rationally and reflectively cultivate your character
structure.
I was a big fan of the series, and I had the idea that I was gonna send John an email and try to set up a video interview. And to my surprise and to my delight, he had agreed to do a video interview, and you can only imagine how excited I was to meet John face to face and ask him these questions.
And I would think, and I'm going to use Kierkegaard's term here, a kind of anxiety about facing these existential challenges, like really facing your mortality, really facing that irremovable aloneness, really facing how much you have been caught up in control. These can be emotionally, even physiologically, unpleasant events.
What do you think it is about our modern lifestyle that exasperates meaninglessness?
So typically, meaning in life is built around three sort of fundamental ways in which people are oriented and making sense of things. So one is people need, they need coherence. They need things to hang together and make sense. And that's what I, in the series, called the nomological order. And that's so, right, how do things make sense? So if you look at our scientific worldview, it tells us how it explains everything, in that sense it gives us intelligibility, but it doesn't explain how we generate explanations. It doesn't explain how we do science. So that pattern of intelligibility, we don't fit into. Now that wasn't always the case. If you go before maybe the 12th century, right? The way things, the intelligibility of things and the way we made sense of them were really very well coupled together. But we've lost that. Like I said, we don't fit in. Our project of making sense doesn't actually fit into the sense that we make. And that's very deeply disruptive. People are also looking for a narrative, right? They want a sense of purpose and direction. We used to have a view of the universe that was teleological. It was a grand cosmic story, you know, beginning, right, and middle, and it came to culmination. That's where the West got its idea of progress from. But as the scientific worldview has unfolded, and in concert with other things like the Protestant Reformation, change in how we use literacy, that narrative order has collapsed. We don't think of the universe. Look, let me give you a clear example. The best story of how we got here biologically is evolution. It is a deep mistake to think of evolution as a teleological process. Evolution is not moving towards any final state, any goal. That's not how it operates. So if our story, if you allow me to bend that term, isn't teleological, which means it's really not a story, right? Like that we came here via evolution, how do we fit back in? How does our sense of acting on purpose, right? It used to be that everything was acting on purpose, if you go to the Aristotelian worldview, but now we seem to be little isolated islands, right? And it's not, well, like, I do all this stuff on purpose, but what's it? It doesn't fit into any overarching thing. And then finally, people have, again, for reasons I just mentioned, we've needed strategies of self-transcendence. We are, the machinery that makes us adaptively intelligent also continually besets us with the threat of self-deception. So we need to transcend ourselves. That's how you get out of self-deception. So we need a normative order that tells us, how can we aspire? How can we transcend? How can we become better than we are? How can we cultivate wisdom? How can we pursue enlightenment? And we used to have, again, a whole, you know, order, way of understanding that, sort of a Neoplatonic Christian thing that made sense of all of that. And that's all collapsed too because of the scientific worldview, the Protestant Reformation, all these stuff I go through historically. So what happens is people can't stop pursuing these things, but now they pursue them. And instead of having a huge cultural machinery and groups of people and traditions and elders and experts that can point to, oh, this is how your cultivation of coherence fits in to, you know, the worldview. This is how your pursuit of purpose fits in, right? And this is how your attempts to transcend fits in. And here's how we can enhance all this. And here's how we can put you in concert with other people. That's all gone.
Just to kind of better understand what's at stake for addressing the meaning crisis, if we don't address it, what do you see happening?
It's already happening. So just think about why people are exodusing into the virtual world, why they think reality is broken, to use the title of a book. These games, think about what they have in them. They have a clear narrative, and you're playing a central role in it. They have a way in which you can level up and self-transcend, right? And they have, right, they have rules that are clear to you and fit you in. Like, they've got all the missing orders, and you can get this deep sense of flow and connectedness in them. People are hungry. So people are going to be more and more tempted, I would say, to escape that way, or to try and take a political, a particular political solution and try and make it do the work that culture and religion used to do for us, right? And I think we're going to see increasing suffering and distress because of that. But if we don't address the meaning crisis, we're going to get increasingly sick and increasingly like enfeebled as we try to make the titanic changes individually and collectively we have to make if we want to save things.
It's easier to level up in the virtual world than the real world. So yeah. Where do we cultivate courage to look inside and level up in our own lives?
That's a very difficult thing. And that gets into a challenge that Agnes Collard talks into her book, her excellent book, Aspiration. Which is, how do you put yourself onto a path to become somebody other than who you currently are? Because you don't have the skills, you don't have the values, you don't have the preferences of that person. And you've got to find a way of doing that. And that's where not having the traditions puts us at a disadvantage. Because often what traditions did is they mythologically, and I don't use that term in a denigrative fashion, they gave us symbols of that. So the Buddhist tradition, your Buddha nature, right? And so you're aspiring to, you know, become at one with your Buddha nature, and it's always you, but it's not yet. And you get this sort of paradoxical language of aspiration. And so the traditions are designed to, the words you want to use are the wrong word. You want to, like, they sort of slide you in. They lead you in. They tempt you in. And what they do is they sort of put you on this continuum where you start to taste, and then as you get a bit of an existential taste for what this is like, that then enables you to then move to a slightly different taste. So you know how we talk about elsewhere acquiring a taste, sometimes literally a taste for a kind of food or a taste in music. It's analogous to that, but more profound. You need, again, a set of practices that has that capacity to resonate with you. It can reach you where you are now, well, and it can satisfy the goals you have right now, but also introduce some destability, right? Destabilizing, right? And because it, oh, yeah, but I want a bit more. So let me give you a concrete example. People come into meditation because they want to relax. They want to de-stress. And you teach them the meditation, but you're honest from the beginning, by the way. No duplicity here. Right? But you say, okay, I'm going to teach you to relax, but I'm going to teach you to relax not just the way you think, because you relax in order to fall asleep. The relaxation you actually need is a kind of relaxation that makes you sensitive and aware in the world, because you actually need to be able to confront your problems better. So I'm going to teach you to relax, but it's going to be a different kind of relaxation. And then as you learn that, you go, oh, I'm now sort of seeing the world a little bit different. You say, okay, now that you get that, I'm going to try and teach you a little bit more about what that seeing is. I'm trying to get you a little bit more of the insight. And you get to, and you go, oh, but now you start to uncover, right, a little bit, oh, this is challenging. This is uncovering some stuff about me and the world. And then you start, and then you say, okay, but notice what's happened along the way. You've got some nascent skills that you've acquired. Now pay attention to those skills that are nascent, that are already in there, because they've been implicit as you've been pursuing these other goals. Let's make those skills more explicit. And that's how I'm going to empower you and to face these challenges that are emerging as your connection is developing. But what I mean is, we can't just theorize about this. You have to get involved in a path.
So moving to meditation, I know you have a tattoo on your arm.
Yeah, both.
Can you tell me what they mean and what they...
This is meditate and this is concentrate. I once had a Chinese woman come up to me. I don't read Chinese, but she said to me, she pointed to my arm and she said, why is your arm telling me to sit quietly? And it's like, I said, well, I thought that means meditate. And she said, oh, yeah, it does. And I said, well, that's what it is, meditation, concentration. I grew up, I'm old enough that I grew up, there was a David Carradine show called Kung Fu, which was sort of one of my first exposures to this. And when he leaves the temple, right, to leave the temple, you have to put your arms on this really hot, like chest, and it burns and it brands and tattoos you. I didn't do something as dramatic as that, but it wasn't pain-free either, right? I got the tattoos to try and also sort of, like him, my entering a way of life, a commitment to a way of life in which meditation and concentration were going to play a significant role.
When are you first introduced to Vipassana meditation?
So 1991. So I've been practicing Vipassana and Metta and Tai Chi Chuan as integrated practices for 28 years. I guess it's going to be closer. Well, no, 27 years. It's going to be closer to 28 soon.
And has it always been a daily practice, meditation?
A daily, always.
Since 1991?
Yep. I mean, there's been one or two days where I've been sick, or where I'll have to reduce the amount of time I practice because there's some exigent, unexpected circumstance that's happened, but every day.
Initially, was there resistance as it became daily? You made it sound easy, you've been practicing every day, and I'm like, oh, here I am struggling, there's been a lot of resistance.
A couple things, I mean, I teach, so I teach meditation and contemplation classes at the Multi-Faith Center, wonderful place at the University of Toronto. So I've been teaching for a long time too, and so I know about that, and that's one of the things I talk with my students. You need to, one thing is, if you try and do this on your own, small chance you'll do it. This is part of the whole problem with being an autodidact, right? You'll either not keep it up, because that's how human beings work, or you'll twist it in a way that you don't understand. So you need to learn with other people, you need to practice with other people. Even if you do a course, right, learn, and then even if you meet with people once a week, people that you trust, trustworthy people, and you meet regularly, that's predictive of you keeping the practice going. But there's other things you need to do, right? So this is like this, I mean, this of course reverberates through all of Buddhism, and I'm not trying to make anybody a Buddhist, right? But this idea of the three refuges. So, right, you want to, that's the Sangha. You want to practice with other people. You transcend yourself through and by means of other people. And it also helps you when you facilitate other people in the practice. So you have to learn with others. You have to practice with others, even just once a week. And then you can practice the rest of the week on your own, right? You need, right? So the three refuges are the Sangha, the Dharma, and the Buddha. The Buddha doesn't mean worship, Siddhartha Gautama. It means make a regular practice. Remember we talked about that aspiration towards your future self? Pay attention, maybe keep a journal, of moments where you did wake up, where you felt, not what you thought or even imagined, but you felt the Buddha nature. You saw things through. Like for a moment, that was your identity. Your Buddha nature was present. Maybe there was a moment of real compassion or real insight or real awareness of a pattern of self-deception you've gotten into. You have to, they talk about like watering your Buddha, right? You've got to, right, celebrate, remember, cultivate that Buddha nature until it more and more becomes something that you can internalize and identify with. Like we said, you have to symbolically, and I don't mean like just the way we've trivialized the word symbol, I mean this enacted symbolism, journaling, remembering, feeling what that's like, because as you connect with that emerging Buddha nature, right, it will actually encourage you to keep going. Next thing, Dharma, learn. Keep learning about the mindfulness practice that you've engaged in. Read about, right, its history. Read about other people who are practicing it. Read two things. Read practical manuals where people are saying, this helped, try this. But also read into the philosophical foundations. How does this sit? You got to zoom into the practice with practical stuff. You have to zoom out with the philosophical stuff. How does this situate within a more comprehensive philosophia, the love and cultivation of wisdom, a whole way of life, transforming. You have to do all of that. If all you're doing is, I'm going to sit for 20 minutes a day by myself, and that's all I'm going to do, it won't take. Well, it might. Sorry, that's presumptuous. Here's what I'm going to say. As a cognitive scientist, I would predict it won't take, because there's a high probability it won't take.
In the earlier days, as you were meditating, maybe you felt that as you got deeper into your practice, you can feel that an old identity is beginning to die. As you're waiting for a new identity to emerge, there's this restlessness and not having.
Oh, yeah. So one of the things I do, and one of the things, like, both scientifically, academically, I've published on this, and also like when I'm teaching, I'm critical of a lot of the ways in which we teach mindfulness to people. I forget the author's name, and I apologize for this. He has this term, he calls it McMindfulness, where we've really trivialized mindfulness, and we've removed it from being this thing that sort of would challenge individuals in society and makes them sort of more content with the status quo and stuff like that. And so there's lots of criticisms there, and if we had more time, I'd go into that. Right, but one of the things that's missing in that McMindfulness is, mindfulness is easy and it's wonderful. That's crap. First of all, it's hard, like for reasons we've just talked about. And secondly, and this is one of the things I talk about, and this is greatly influenced reading the tradition, but also from academic influence from a person called Willoughby Britton, because you're going to hit some dark stuff. You're going to hit some dark, and you can use some, and I talk about different things you can hit from the, like when you first start meditating, I warn people about this, like don't meditate in the dark or anything like that, because you can be sitting there meditating, it'll feel like an electric bolt just went through you, or you can suddenly get really hot, or you can suddenly get really cold, or you can be sitting there and you know you're alone and you hear your voice yelled out, and you can think, oh, I'm going crazy, right? Right? And all of that. And if you don't know, and if you don't have people out there who forewarned you, tell you how to deal with it, that can spin off. There's a finesse to this, right? Again, I'm so influenced by the discussion I was having this morning with Peter Lindbergh and Soryu, right? It's like you have to, people, again, this is this courage. If you water down and McDonald's, sorry, I shouldn't say McDonald's, McMindfulness. Sorry, I apologize for that. Right? The practice so that it avoids all of this stuff. People are not going to get the deep change they need. You have to take them to the precipice of instability, because the structure has to be broken up. But if you do it too fast or push them too hard, you can horrify them, right? I'll just make it comfortable, then they also won't go through the change.
So the meditation app on the App Store that you do by yourself is a recipe for failure?
I would not recommend it because, I have to be careful. Depends what we're talking about. It's relative to your goal. If you just want to sort of get a bit of, you know, easygoing mindfulness and de-stress a little bit, and that's fine. But if you want to cultivate wisdom, if you want to deeply enrich your capacity for meaning with yourself and with other people and with your world, then that's not going to do it for you. That's not going to do it for you. And you have to be really careful also, by the way. A lot of these apps, I've been on the inside in some meetings where people are making these devices, and this is where I can talk as a cognitive scientist. A lot of these apps promise things they can't deliver. We might have apps and technology that can, look, there's no consensus within the scientific community about what mindfulness is. There's no consensus about what are, you know, its underlying cognitive processes. There's a lot of intellectually respectable ideas, but there's nothing, it's not definitive yet. We don't, if you were to tell me, oh, this is how mindfulness plays out in the brain, I don't believe you. I just don't believe you. I don't think you can track that. So you're probably only tracking things that are semi-reliably correlated with mindfulness. I've known this for people who have experienced meditation practices, and they are using one of these apps, and the app is giving them all kinds of error signal, but they're doing a practice that has been vetted for thousands of years and takes them into a deep state of mindfulness because the app has been calibrated to correlate with something that doesn't line up with how mindfulness is being induced within this tradition, etc. So I'm suspicious of all of those apps, right? Again, I don't think they can give you the deep transformation. I'm also suspicious of them as technology, because I don't think the science is there for the technological claims.
I have one last question.
Sure.
I was at, I did an interview last week at a meditation studio in Ottawa, and before the interview, the teacher invited me to a class to sit for a sitting. So I got there and I noticed really quickly that I was the only guy in the classroom. And I asked her what the ratio is, and she said, we have about 20% male students. And when I go to yoga or when I'm in meditation, I notice there's a large disparity, or there's much more women in the class. And I feel that maybe there's a resistance in men to do something that feels counter to what we define as masculinity. I don't even know if we have a definition for men or masculinity. That definition isn't there, or we don't have an agreed upon definition, so we're left to ourselves to figure it out, and then to move to a practice that involves openness and vulnerability, it can feel counter to what we are as men. Or I'm trying to ask.
No, I understand that. I'm not going to jump on you. If you're sort of struggling. That's unfair to you. I appreciate what you're trying to say.
So is for men that resistance to maybe the yin or something that feels more feminine? Mm-hmm. What would your advice be?
I think that point about men. I'm uncomfortable with these terms, and I'm not trying to pigeonhole you with them. Men coming more into, let's use yin rather than femininity, sure, because that's more helpful. Men coming more into, like, you know, the yin side of things. Yeah, there's definitely a cultural thing that needs to be done here. One way I would recommend goes back to the first thing I say. You've got to understand that this yang pursuit of spirituality, where, you know, man and responsibility, and again, I'm not saying stop doing that, but that yang and that yin, and also the women, it has to go both ways. The yin and the yang, wow, this sounds so cliche and I don't mean it. There's a reason why in the center of the white, there's a black dot, and in the center of the black, there's a white dot, and the relation is they're interdependent and dynamically self-organizing. They deeply, deeply need each other. And, you know, and so both of these self-isolations in the pursuit of spirituality as a response to the meaning crisis, both of them have to open up towards each other in a better fashion, both as communities and within individuals. So I think it's something we should be saying to everybody, sort of, but from both sides. That's my response to that.
I'm a big proponent of meditation and mindfulness and just trying to, I mean, those are toxic words right now. Meditation and mindfulness.
Are they?
Yeah, they've been thrown around by too many knuckleheads. Like there's something about it that it's like, oh, that's kind of a bullshitty word. You know what I mean? You're like, oh, I'm just all about mindfulness. Like, you're annoying. That's what you are. When a word gets moved around and used too much, like something happens to it where it gets icky.
So meditation is not just about sitting and becoming calm, although that's a stabilizing part of meditation, the stabilization of the mind, which then can be used as a more sharper instrument for inquiry into the nature of reality, into the nature of the self.
So your book, McMindfulness, how would you describe McMindfulness to someone who hasn't come across your work?
Well, there are probably different layers of it. Probably the top is just the complete kind of almost silly, commodified usage of mindfulness to sell products. I mean, that's the most crass layer. You see people selling, I mean, even Kentucky Fried Chicken is, right, has co-opted mindfulness to sell chicken pot pies.
Meditation system.
But then there's the layer beneath that, which is really how it's been decontextualized from any kind of ethical or moral framework, or at least any kind of greater moral social vision. And that's a long history behind how that occurred. And some of the side effects of maybe unintended consequences of that. So now we see hedge fund managers, for example, going through mindfulness courses on Wall Street. Or we see U.S. Marines being taught mindfulness before they are shipped off to Afghanistan.
But we tried to translate it. We tried to translate it to something that the soldiers understood. So the zeroing of the weapon. To be clear, to block out everything else, when you're a marksman, you have to be able to see the target and be on point to make sure you're hitting what you want to hit.
Headshot.
I think one of the key things is that it's turned into a technique. In other words, it's become a tool.
As opposed to
a path. It's not a spirit. It's not a path of spiritual liberation. It becomes a tool for various ends, pragmatic, utilitarian ends. Now, the other aspect of McMindfulness, particularly how it's been employed in corporations, but also in public schools, is that it functions as a way to help individuals to adjust and accommodate and cope with the status quo, rather than functioning as a way of challenging social, political, economic realities that caused the modern our distress in the first place.
If there is a hunger for the ethical and moral framework that's missing from McMindfulness, how can one go about cultivating those?
Well, one of the things I think we have to take into account, McMindfulness is really more a cult of the self, or the cult of radical individualism. Whereas if we're going to reclaim mindfulness and try to decouple it from the marketplace, I think we have to look at the motivation for why we want to actually engage in it, in mindfulness practice in the first place. A lot of people come to meditation because they want health benefits, and that's a good place to start. But the deeper and more profound aspects of mindfulness is about radical cultivating radical a sense of radical interdependence with all sentient beings and all the biosphere, for that matter. And so from that perspective, I think we have to, number one, look at our motivation. Number two, have a wider social vision for why we're engaging in this practice. Is it all just to make myself a better test taker on exams, or to help me climb the corporate ladder for career success, or does it go beyond self concerns? And so in that case, we have to challenge the notion that it's a privatized spirituality. We have to kind of challenge that idea.
Do you think there's a risk where, because these apps are so frequently downloaded, there's a risk where someone who wants to begin a mindfulness practice engages one of these apps, and because there's no communal aspect, and because it's missing other elements, they walk away from it thinking, okay, well, this just isn't for me, not realizing that that wasn't actually what they were being served.
That's right. And I mean, we've seen sort of meditation, Buddhist meditation, reduced to mindfulness, and now mindfulness is being reduced to these very simplified apps. And so someone may think that's all there is to meditation or to mindfulness, and then they, if it doesn't work for them, again, they're coming, probably approaching it because they want a quick fix of some kind. And they believe in an app will do that. So they become very popular. They're very accessible to people. You can download them, of course. But I think they're problematic in the sense that someone can try it and then think maybe there's even something wrong with them because it didn't work. Because they've been told that look what it can do. You know, you get all the hype about the benefits of mindfulness and how it changes the brain. And, well, I tried it and it didn't seem to do much for me. But that's what happens when you frame it as a privatized spirituality and it then becomes like a do-it-yourself technique, DIY technique. And you can use an app, but the stresses that you're trying to de-stress from, they're going to continue, you know, especially if you're in the corporation, if you're in a corporate workplace. And I think this is the wrong message. We're sending the wrong message that it's not a DIY endeavor. And that people can find other ways to manage stress by finding the resources they need in their environments. In other words, are you lonely? Are you by yourself? Things like this. There's even been studies on apps that say that they don't have an underlying evidence base, they lack scientific credibility, limited clinical effectiveness, and it's kind of an irony, isn't it, to have to turn to an app to de-stress from the problems that are making us often made worse by smartphones themselves. Right. So it's kind of an irony, I think.
So after 3 months of daily meditation, I now sit cross-legged and I hold my hands like this every time I'm seated. No, I'm just kidding. But it's been 100 days of meditating every day. And I just thought now I would talk about my experience, what I've learned, what I've come to realize. It's been 100 days and I guess none of my fears have come true. There's a lot of resistance as we begin a spiritual practice such as meditation. What if this kills all my motivation? And what if I start meditating and I don't feel anything? And what if I start meditating and I won't be productive? And what if I start meditating and I go crazy? Haven't lost my motivation. Yeah, I haven't gone crazy. If anything, I feel more excited to create because the engine driving my creativity isn't so much ego, it is heart and love. And I think really that's what I've been coming to realize in the past 100 days. When we meditate, we are creating more distance and separation between ourselves and our mind, and we're connecting to our heart, we're connecting to love. I'm kind of struggling for words, but we're leaving our mind and we're connecting something deeper than our mind. And that can be scary because we identify with our mind and our thoughts, and stepping away from that it can almost feel as if we are stepping away from who we are and what we think we are. And it's coming to the realization that we're a lot more than what we think we are. We're, there is an awareness of what we think we are, and we're connecting with that awareness. And for reasons that I don't completely understand, but I felt it's, I feel that our brains have a resistance to connecting to something deeper than the mind. And I think that fear comes out of the fear of the unknown. Right now, most of us, we live our lives and our mind, our brain, our thoughts are at the steering wheel. When we start meditating, we put our heart at the steering wheel, and we don't know where our heart will take us. We don't know what that road will be. We don't know where it will go, but it is going to take us on a journey. And when our brain is on the steering wheel, because it is so afraid of the world and everything, it doesn't even leave the parking lot. And while it's safe, we never really get to evolve and grow and develop. But we almost sacrifice that journey for the comfort of our surroundings. And in this case, the comfort of who we think we are in this moment and what we think we are. And meditation is letting go of that and letting something else take the wheel. I mean, seeing where it takes us. And it's going to take us to other people. It's going to take us to a deeper understanding of ourselves. It's going to take us to more meaning in life. And I'm not going to sit here and say that, yes, I've alleviated and fixed myself in 100 days. No, it's, if anything, it's, I've developed this habit that now I've realized that I need to continue doing day to day for the rest of my life. It's not something that I'm going to abandon. It's something that I really need. And the skills that I've gained meditating are skills that I've started to develop, and skills that I will hopefully now take with me to the rest of my life, and skills that I can strengthen. But I think from a mental health perspective, after 3 months, I'm in a much better place now than I was 3 months ago. Again, not, I don't want to oversell or glorify what the practice can do, but I think I'm in a much better spot. I'm in a much better place mentally than I was 3.5 months ago. And not so much because I've changed. It's because I've developed more space between myself and my thoughts. And three months ago, I was so attached to my thoughts, I thought I am my thoughts. And because we have so many thoughts of all kinds, dark, bizarre, intrusive, absurd, if we identify with our thoughts, things can get scary. Things can get dark. And it's not as if I don't have those thoughts anymore. It's more of a realization that I'm not my thoughts, and I've learned how to better watch my thoughts. And I've been able to detach from those thoughts, which makes me feel more at peace. Because now I'm not a slave to my mind. It's, if there is a thought, I have become better able to watch it come and pass. Instead of following that thought with another thought and getting stuck in a loop of thoughts, which it seems that our brain wants us to do. And that's something that I've realized in the past 3 months. It's, our brain has a really hard time just being still. And meditation is how we train our brain to be still, because an untrained mind keeps turning and turning and turning for the sake of turning and turning. It's almost if our brain, just to catch our attention, would give us a thought of fear or anxiety or insecurity just for the sake of us coming back to it. And because it doesn't like to be still, it doesn't like to just sit in the present. It likes to be used, and it likes to pull us back in to its game of continual thinking. And in the past 3 months, there's just been more moments of presence where for a moment, I find myself fully immersed in the present moment, where I have a second of being in the here and now, not thinking about the future or thinking about the past, just being in the fullness of the moment that I'm in. And in the past 3 months, that's gone from a few seconds to a few longer moments. And I'm looking forward to increasing my capacity to be more in the present, and not just thinking for the sake of thinking. It's when we overthink and we can't let go of thinking, when it becomes addictive, that's when we really start to suffer. I think in the past 3 months, with the conversations that I've had, I've realized that meditation is just the beginning. It's a practice. Both John and Ron have multiple practices, and I've realized that this is just one practice of many that I will spend my life cultivating. I've realized that it's also not enough for me to sit and do this by myself every day. There's an importance of community, and I'm looking forward to meditating with other people and making an effort to go for a group sitting as often as I can. I think meditation has really given me some tools where I'm better able just to face life. Instead of running from life, I'm at a place where now I want to engage with it and experience it. I'm not afraid for life to hit me, and I'm not afraid to hit back. And yeah, whether that's through my creativity, whether that's through love, whether that's through service, I'm not afraid to hit back at life. I've been ranting for a while, so I just want to finish this off. I think there's a lot of personal benefits to be had, and that can, you could use that to start your own meditation practice. But I think deeper than the personal benefits that you can experience, what I'm hoping might inspire you to start your own practice is, I was thinking the other day, with all the technology we have, it's never been so easy to escape from the present moment. And the more we escape from the present moment to our screens, the more we forget how to be here. And When we meditate, we remember how to be here. We remember how to live. And in 2019, we are forgetting how to live. And if you can cultivate a meditation, a mindfulness practice, and you can remember how to live and how to be here, you are a lighthouse to the world. The people who remember how to live in 2019 and the people who remember and can help other people remember, those will be the unsung heroes of the 21st century. And we're at a time in human history where there's never been a greater need for remembering. So start this practice, not so much for yourself, but start this practice so you can help others remember. Because I think that's what's really needed now more than ever.